Hello and welcome to today's lunchtime concert. Before we begin, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land upon which this concert takes place and pay my respects to elders past, present, and emerging. Today, the UQ School of Music presents three of our performance fellows, violinist Adam Chalabi, pianist Anna Grinberg, and cellist Patrick Murphy. A quick reminder that this concert is being live streamed, so to our live audience, if you have any electronic devices, if you could please ensure that they are switched off or on silent. And now, without further ado, please make our artists welcome.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Nickson Room Lunchtime Series from the University of Queensland. Today, Anna, Patrick, and I will present a programme of two piano trios which represent the evolution of the ensemble from its refined early classical beginnings, the Haydn, to its development into a powerful and expressive tool of the Romantic era, which the Brahms showcases perfectly. Joseph Haydn is well known as a pioneer of the string quartet. What is less recognized is the pivotal role he played in cultivating the piano trio. A brief survey of Haydn's trios traces the development of the genre from what is essentially the Baroque trio sonata, in which the cello doubles the left hand of the keyboard part, to the classical trio, in which each instrument achieves a new degree of independence. The work we are performing today comes from the period of 1794 to 95, during Haydn's second visit to London, a prolific period of his life in terms of his compositional output. Then, in his early 60s, Haydn was at the height of his powers. This was the period of his final six London symphonies, and the piano trios composed in London demonstrate a similar sophistication. His earlier piano trios, intended for the growing number of amateur musicians, were often in only two movements of no great complexity. The London trios, however, are much more refined music. They are in three movements and show greater individuality than the earlier trios. Haydn was certainly aware of the market for music like this amongst London's professional musicians, and especially amongst the city's many skilled amateur musicians, and he published these late trios in London rather than in Vienna. The second work we perform today shifts us forward almost a century then to 1882. Brahms' C major trio exudes the confidence, happiness, and fulfillment of a composer at the peak of his powers, who enjoyed the recognition of peers and audiences as one of the greatest of his time. With uncharacteristic pride, Brahms wrote to his publisher, Simrock, "You have not so far had such a beautiful trio from me, and very probably have not published one to match it in the last 10 years." Following his long-standing custom of trial of his own compositions by private performance, Brahms first revealed the C major trio in its entirety, along with the concurrently composed F major string quintet, before private audiences in August and October of 1882. In December that year, Brahms paid Clara Schumann a surprise visit and was delighted to find her trying out the trio with friends. Finally, Brahms gave the public premiere on December the 29th in Frankfurt. The work was well received, but Clara complained privately in her diary that Brahms's playing had degenerated into thump, bang, and scrabble, one of the costs of giving up piano practice with his rise as a composer. The other movements of the trio possess the epic scale, the outer movements of the trio possess the epic scale and vast palette of colours typical of Brahms's writing. Perhaps the reason this work is so admired, though, and why Brahms was so proud of his creation, is the musical rhetoric of the middle two movements, a hugely lyrical and impassioned set of variations on a Hungarian-influenced theme, together with a largely hushed and elusive scherzo with a sonorous and expansive trio section.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.